everyone. Welcome to the MARPE Diplo Talk Bucharest edition. I'm very, very glad to see you that this day is finally here. It's been in the making for a few months now. We're gonna keep it a little bit formal, a little bit informal, okay? Okay, so this third event in the MARPE Talk series is of course in Bucharest. The other two were in Belgium, in Ghent, the first one, and then the second one was in Valencia in Spain. So two of my colleagues are relaxed now. I am the one with the event now, and then we have two other colleagues in Portugal and France that will organize two more MARPE Diplo Talks in the following months. All right, so I'm gonna start by telling you a little bit about the project so that you understand exactly what is the context of our event. Of course, further on, if you have any other questions, please let me know. I'm more than happy to talk about this wonderful project. And after I tell you a little bit about the MARPE Diplo project and about the MARPE network, we're gonna start our talk with our five guest speakers, and we're gonna really go into the discussion about civic diplomacy. Overall, it will be about 2 hours, 2 hours and 15, and after that, about 12:30, we're gonna stop and we're gonna enjoy a nice lunch, right? All right. So, just a few things. Maybe I should start with my name. Hello, my name is Anca Anton, and I'm the local representative for the MARPE network and part of the MARPE Diplo team. I'm going to tell you a little bit about the project. So basically, MARPE Diplo is the short name. That is the long name, and you see the need for a short version. But basically, in the name of the project, you see the goal of our project. So basically, our aim is to develop a European curriculum, a European higher education curriculum regarding public, corporate, and civic diplomacy. This over a period of 3 years through an Erasmus Plus project. Now, there are a few just administrative things about the project. So we are five universities working together for this project, but not only for the project, because the project is developed by a network, the MARPE network, formed now of five universities. We were six, but then Brexit, so five. And we have a series of activities. In these activities, we also partner with other organizations that are associated partners. They are think tanks, professional PR associations, or researchers. For example, in Romania, our associated partner is the Romanian Public Relations Association. Cătălin, Hosu is a representative, the one in the middle. I will introduce you to the speakers in just a few minutes. I singled it out. And then throughout the project, we collaborate on specific aspects with all of these associated partners. Now, in terms of activities, one of the activities of the project is the MARPE Talk series. As I told you, we have a series of five such events. Now, we already had the one in Ghent, and this was the topic. It was on Brexit. It was a very interesting discussion. Then we had the one in Valencia in Spain. It was on corporate diplomacy, and now we are having the one in Bucharest. Just for a second, I forgot the name of the city. The one in Bucharest about civic diplomacy. After these three, we are going to have two others that are going to integrate and look for, let's say, the intersection of these three. In addition to to this spring. We have the other ones I told you in Lisbon, in Portugal, and then in France. And another activity is the MARPE ISP, which is an intensive study program. It's a period of 2 weeks where about 45-50 students from all over Europe come together in Ghent, in Belgium, and discuss these three topics together with academics and professionals. This is actually a long-standing tradition for our project. We started long ago. Now we have here some of the students that attended in 2019 the ISP, and we also have one who attended. When were you here? In 2014. So our previous project, and I'm very happy that we have this continuity. So this is actually a very interesting event. There's a lot to talk about it. It's for students mainly. So if you have any questions about it, please let me know. Well, later on during lunch. Now there are a few. I just brought a few pictures. So these are last year's youth. There are a series of activities that we do, well, social and academic, during this ISP. This is us. Most of the project team. Most of us are here now. Now, before we start, just a few things, because I know some of you are not accustomed or don't really have an in-depth knowledge about our topic. So our starting point was traditional diplomacy, you know, when diplomats interact with diplomats from other countries. But we went further and we talked about public diplomacy, so when diplomats or governments interact with publics, non-diplomatic publics. Then we went into corporate diplomacy, so this activity, the diplomatic activity done by organizations, by corporations, and then civic diplomacy. So when you take traditional diplomacy, but you don't have diplomats, you have the public that has its own agenda and its own interest, what do you have? So this is the starting point for today's discussion. What do we have when traditional diplomacy just leaves the place for civic diplomacy, for the public? Right? So how exactly do we translate this whole area that is very documented, that is very researched, and we explore this new area that really doesn't have a lot of research, needs a lot of investigation, because we've seen a surge of civic activities throughout the world. And we're gonna try to explore it a little bit today with our speakers. So this is the start of the talk. I'm very glad that our five speakers accepted my invitation to participate. I am very glad that these were the five people that I wanted to ask, and they all said yes. So thank you very much for that. It made my life very, very easy. So the idea behind this panel is to bring different perspectives on this topic, on the topic of civic diplomacy. So we have an academic, my colleague Camelia, Cmeciu. Then we have, maybe I should do it. So you can see their name. Yeah, here we go. So we have the academic perspective, then we have the professional association perspective, and here we have two representatives. So on the one hand is Anna Maria Diceanu, who is the president and the co-founder of Global Women in PR Romania. Then we have Cătălin Hosu, who is vice president of the Romanian PR Association. So this is a different perspective on this topic. And then we have a topic coming from the civil society, and we have two representatives from two NGOs that I personally like very much, and that represent two areas that play an increasingly important role, which is law and technology. So we have Cătălin Pojoranu from Foundations, and then we have Olivia, Vereha from Code for Romania. So these are our two perspectives that I hope will enrich our understanding of this topic. So how how will this go? Each of our speakers will present their thoughts, their general thoughts on and their general perspective, specific perspective on the topic, and then we'll have a little bit of a discussion based on bringing together, on the idea of bringing together this five perspectives. All right, so this is where I give the floor to our first speakers. So first will be Camelia Cmeciu, who will give us her perspective on this intersection of strategic communication and civic movements, so we can move towards civic diplomacy. All right, so I will start your presentation.
Thank you. So my name is Camelia. The surname is a bit difficult, but it's Cmeciu. Okay. My role here is to present actually the academic part of this strategic communication and civic movement. So there will be authors. Okay. So do not panic. But I will try to bring actually the applied part of research. Okay. For that to be very handy for all of us. Okay, I'm sure that we are all familiar with images like this. Okay, Egypt occupied movement, Spain, coming from Spain, Poland and Romania. Now, we as researchers have a question. How do we approach these images? How do we analyze civic movements? Okay, so in my perspective, we have at least two ways of tackling civic movements. On the one hand, we have castells with network of brains, with horizontality, sorry, of networks, okay? And this supports vitalist movement of collective faces, something that I understood that we'll discuss later on, this vitalist movement of collective faces. On the other hand, we have Jovado, who actually says that we have collective action is always structured, and that we have choreography of assembly. So we have to start when dealing with civic movements with these two perspectives. Now, even if we have a sort of agreeing or disagreeing with some researchers, there are some common points for castells, okay? Those who adopt castell and those who adopt the bottle. So we have actually Fuchs, one of the researchers who severely criticized Castel, but at the same time he agreed with some points in Castel's work. So he said, okay, we have, what Castel did was to identify that we have some objective conditions which triggered those civic movements. On the other hand, Fuchs agrees that we have emotions of outrage and hope, and they play a very important role in the transition from crisis to protest. So this is what Fuchs said to Castel opinions. But in a way, having the title strategic communication, I was in a way forced, let us say between brackets, to adopt Jovado, because he said that we should talk when having civic movements about the choreography of assembly. So automatically, today my point of view would be that protesters are entrepreneurs, or as Jovado says, they are communicators. So this is my point of view today. I'll come back a bit to the network of brains. What do protests and strategic communication have in common? The two main words are change and social reform. So this is what we should see beyond strategic communication and civic movements. This change, this social reform, that they in a way imply when they take place. Now, coming to strategic communication, what Castel said, and it was agreed upon that all these civil social movements and the protesters have an awareness of credence. This awareness of credence, I think that should be related to the definition by Hallahan and his colleagues about strategic communication, namely the purposeful use of communication by an organization to fulfill its mission. So we have awareness of credence within civic movements, and we have the mission within strategic communication. What I adopted today was the chapter actually on strategic communication linked to diplomacy, in a way to link this to civic diplomacy. And in the Routledge Handbook of Strategic Communication, we have these five stages. Namely, going from orientation in the course of the current mission to strategy process, content of strategy, strategic communications plans, and alignment of strategies. So mission, with a mission, we have to go beyond, okay, the individualized nature of every social experience, and we have to go towards common collective identifications. Now, these common collective identifications, they create a unique identity, and the point is how groups, be they civic movements or whatever, legitimize their in-group and out-group identity. And I brought two examples, sorry, I did not translate the mission of corruptia ucide, corruption kills in Romania, but it is interesting how they shaped their mission. And the legitimation was done actually through diversity. And it was interesting to see that this diversity did not stuck only to age, but also to physical appearance. Blonde hair, dark hair, red hair. So they, in a way, tried to include all categories. On the other hand, we have the mission of Greenpeace International. And the legitimation is done actually through, let us say, a sort of juxtaposition. How people see a forest. For someone, is seen as lumber, for the other ones, it is a home, a heritage, or a future. And that was interesting to see legitimation through difference. Now, coming to another part of strategic communication, we have to talk about strategy process. We have six layers that are in a way interconnected. So coming from situational environmental analysis to issues, to goals, issues and stakeholders, to goals and objectives, evaluation, implementation, and then evaluation of the strategy. Now coming to objectives, the theory on civic movements talks about, do we have short objectives or do we have long-term objectives? Now, some of the researchers say that when we have a civic movement related to internet-mediated issues, we have short-term objectives. And these actually short-term objectives give a fragile movement. Now, the point is that in order to turn this fragile movement into something that is durable, the literature of the authors say that the triggered emotional power of outrage, okay, goes firsthand to mobilize citizens around narrow objectives, so this is amplification, but on the other hand, to make it durable, it should be connected to a more transformatory socio-political agenda. Coming to protesters, here there is actually the social demographic profile of the protesters when you have the resist protest in Romania, and it was interesting to see that even if it was, okay, a huge protest, the IRES actually survey showed that more than 50% of Romanians believe that there is no major change in Romania with this protest. And those who were proud of the movement were actually young adults between 18 and 35. They have faculty degree, and they live in an urban area. Now, what does this mean? Okay, protests, okay, linked to internet. In the literature, there is a tendency to link this type of movements to lifestyle movements or to alter activists. And in Romania, it was linked to what is called in the literature recreative activists. This recreative activist is for those who actually protest during their free time, okay, who believe that this type of protest has socially redeeming values, okay, and it is a way of taking part in protests. So recreative activists, they are less influenced by ideologies, they are less commitment than classic activists, and it is interesting to answer the question, is this recreative activism actually selectivist or not? So this is one way of tackling protesters. Another part of strategic communication is content of strategies, and we have to talk about issues, specific communication programs and means. I will stick to the literature on collective action framing because it is, these are the authors who are heavily used in civic movements. Namely, we talk about diagnostic framing, so identifying the problem. We talk about prognostic framing, talking about let us take a solution, to find a solution, and let us talk about motivational framing, the action. Now, irrelevant. Why? Because every group of protesters actually come with a cultural kit, with some symbols, with some heritage that they have in that culture. And here are just two examples for framing. The framing that we have, for example, for anti-fracking movement in Romania and in the UK, the framing for Romania was the culturally relevant symbol was the aurochs, and the aurochs is present on the coat of arms in the Moldavia part, where the peasants actually were those who initiated the protest, and we have this framing of that was interesting in a study that I did, that the land struggle was the most frequently used frame in anti-fracking in Romania, whereas on the other part, don't frack with your future. Frack has actually a sort of sexual connotation here with the word. So it is interesting to see this dichotomy between framings in different cultural areas. Now, coming to alignment of strategy, and that is important. Okay, who identify the frames, but how do they develop within a civic movement? And in the literature, we have four types: bridging, amplification, extension, and transformation. And I'll exemplify with the collective movement, protest in Romania. So the frame bridging is the use of a cultural symbol, namely the Romanian flag with a hole in it. Then we have frame amplification, and these examples are actually taken from Twitter. This frame amplification with all the cities where the protest took part, and then we have the numbers, the growing numbers that happened last night, let us say, and this night. Then we have frame extension relating to how to mobilize other protesters to come, and then we have frame transformation going from grief, because during the collective protest, actually, the collective protest was triggered by the death of several people, actually, who died in a crowd. And then we have the grief going to outrage. Another way of taking alignment of strategies is to go within two axes, namely, how is mode of interaction actually implemented? Going from personal to impersonal, or the mode of engagement, going from entrepreneurial to institutional engagement. Okay. With the mode of interaction there, it was, how do we approach citizens? And I brought some images there with the mode of interaction face to face, where cities actually are seen as modes of democracy, because people meet there, okay, who have resist protest or anti-fracking protest in Romania. So this is mode of interaction going personal, face to face. On the other hand, that's the mode of interaction where the protesters are involved online. For example, that was interesting, the mini protest of Greenpeace against Shell and Lego, where children were involved to take part in the protest. Then we have the point of engagement, and we as researchers are asking ourselves, at least I am asking myself, how do we tackle all these users who use Twitter, Facebook, and so on? I use, for example, network analysis. And this network analysis helps me to identify the information starters, whose Now, this is, for example, a network analysis that I obtained during the resist protest in Romania. I extracted the tweets, okay, and it was interesting to see that that bridge, that is the top influencer, actually is a Romanian, or was, sorry, was a Romanian coming from, who lives in Brussels. So this is another perspective than the Facebook account of protest, because some of my colleagues Facebook and they had other results than Twitter. So this network analysis is important, in my opinion, to identify all the influencers. Now, in a way, trying to finish this, there is another perspective on alignment of strategy, namely, this in a way interdependence between collective action, where the organizations are, let us say, the organizers, and then we have in the other part we have connective action, where there is no involvement of organizations, and the are very important, and we have something in between the connective action, where we have organizationally enabled networks. And in my opinion, civic diplomacy, okay, and here I have a definition coming from the Center for Citizens Diplomacy. Civic diplomats are motivated by a responsibility to engage with the rest of the world in a meaningful, mutually beneficial dialogue. So I think that civic diplomacy should be somewhere in between collective and connective action. So not only citizens are responsible, but also organizations together. So coming back and summing up everything that I said, I think that it's important to understand the objective of the program or the protest, to create an online group with permanent activity where these frames should be aligned. We should have an alignment of framing. And it is important to create an external space, so something outside of the online, to connect with others, okay, to initiate offline actions, and of course to have media support. That would be all. And the question would be, do we have recreative diplomacy, at least in Romania, or not? Thank you very much.
Presentation for 15 minutes. All right. So this is one perspective. It's a very rich perspective on various dimensions of our discussion on strategic communication and civic movements. Now we're gonna move forward, and I'm gonna invite Anna Maria Diceanu to give us a little bit of a different perspective. Association.
You can leave the presentation because it's in Romanian. So I don't know why she wanted me here. I'm the most uncivilized speaker. So I managed to talk with her yesterday. So my presentation is in Romanian. So ignore it.
I will just leave the first slide.
Perfect. So hi, I'm Anna Maria Diceanu. I'm President of Global Women in PR Romania. I'm a PR person for 19 years. And I'm very happy these days because my specialty is crisis communication. And I'm very busy these days. Talking about what Camelia said, and now I understand why you wanted me here. So this was the formal presentation, and now it comes the informal. So actually, the organization started in 2015 in UK, and her main objective was to diminish the gap between the salaries of men and women in PR. And if I ask you how many women and men are in PR, do you know? So are there more men or more women in PR?
Women.
So actually, in Romania, we are about 90%. So everybody asks, why do you launch Global Women in PR Romania? Because we don't have an issue. But at global level, the percentage is somehow the same. So 80% are women. But if we look at the person who are actually running PR agencies, 70% are men. Romania is in this situation very good because we are 90% women running agencies. So, but at global level we have an issue, and this is one of the issues, let's say, where we try to communicate, we try to have studies, we try to make our voices heard. But on the other hand, PR has also the role of helping brands actually being socially involved, because everybody now wants from a brand to have a voice. So when I buy now a brand, I want to share my values with them. I want them to step up when there is a social issue. I want brands to talk. Unfortunately, in Romania, we saw the examples, few brands had the courage to talk during the social movement. So yes, there were some brands in the telecom industry going there in the market and offering free Wi-Fi, okay. But it wasn't communicated. So no brand was actually on the street saying, we are with these guys, we want to have a voice together with them. Actually, we had a situation of a PR crisis when a CEO of a company went out to the streets, and actually the company was bullied by the government. I think the PR people were sweating bullet because the CEO made a personal decision which actually impacted on the company. So from this point of view, I think PR should play a very important role in helping brands being more involved in social issues and civic movements. I haven't seen any Romanian brand, and I hope to see more, because we have very big global examples. Also, when the Me Too movement started, a lot of brands took action. I would like to see this year more Romanian brands involved. Also, when the movement with the 1 kilometer highway started, I don't know, how many brands have you seen stepping up for the movement? How many brands have you seen involved and saying, okay, my employees won't work for 15 minutes starting 3 o'clock? Have you seen any brands?
Yes.
What brands?
Mainly startups and small companies.
I mean big brands with big impact on the society. Brands we all want to buy it. We are top of our minds. Have you seen one? No. I think this is a part where the role of PR should change in the companies. And I see a lot of students in the PR, I see some of them. And we should think about involving the brands more in this movement. It's difficult because sometimes business objectives and communication and reputation objectives clash and they don't match. But if we look at what consumers would like to see from the brands, we see a lot of bottom-up movements from consumer asking brands to do things, and after that the brands change. And I don't think this is necessarily a good approach, although, yes, the civic movements have helped the brands change their strategy and their strategic approach, but I really believe that PR should make more let's say have a better voice in the company, because this is also an issue. PR in companies are not that good seen. Marketing is better seen because marketing sells. But if we think that PR is about reputation and anything related to reputation actually help brands sell, then we should have a better voice and a stronger voice in companies in order to help brand get involved in civic movement, in social issues, and helping those NGOs who actually won't have the power on their own to do good things, together with brands to make it to results. And this is what I wanted to say for now. So
Romania, women are a bit more represented in public management level. I was at a conference where we talked exactly about this, and the situation in other countries is basically reversed.
Exactly.
All right. So, thank you very much, Anna. We're going to move towards. We're going to stay in the professional association and PR area, but moving forward to our next speaker. I have a very let's say a personal warm relation with the Public Relations Association in Romania. I started my professional activity as an intern for this association. So my first contact with PR and my first internship was in this association, and I'm very glad that I was able to keep in touch, and basically I'm so happy that we have this part and that we in your project. So I invite Cătălin to tell us a little bit about, well, his experience, because his experience is a little bit larger than just the association. Right.
Better a little bit to Anna Maria and global women in PR. Very interesting figures about men and women in PR in Romania. So I feel inspired now to start Romanian in PR. Yes, you know, I want to men's rights in this industry to be respected also. But before that, is something that I think we should acknowledge that the small brands, the small startups, the individuals, the local projects are also important, and they can involve quite a lot in the civic diplomacy. I was listening to a couple of podcasts this week, as I was not very familiar with the new concepts of civic diplomacy and with the MARPE project, and I found very interesting, I would say, and very explanatory definition of public diplomacy. Public diplomacy is instruments that international actors use in order to advance their foreign policy goals by engaging with the foreign public. So from here, it is quite clear that the civil diplomacy is somehow the independent diplomatic activities of non-state actors working across borders, whether they engage states, market entities, or create civil society organizations. We've seen a lot of examples in the civil society, and it is basically one of the examples that I wanna talk about after the presentations, the one with the protests in Bucharest. But I will start with this presentation about a small local NGO project which was started to celebrate the city, the community, and the people. It is a small project that was initiated by people, and it is, I would say, an example of why and how you can get involved in your community. How can you make a change? Because basically, at the end of the day, before going to sleep, there is a lot of people that are that wants to answer a question: how did you contribute to the society today? And by everything that we can do through this civil diplomacy, we can call it civil diplomacy now, but we can call it whatever you like, and we call it in many ways till now. So basically, community and the involvement and the communication and the education, and organizations and communities do a lot in a town. It is about Deva, the project was DEVA 750. It is basically the birth of the city was in 1069, so they were celebrating 750 years. Last year, it was an association called Associația DEVA, and a company that put together this this project. And why was that? Because all of those, they were loving the town, they were living in, they were loving the area, they were loving the people, the traditions, the values, whatever is in a city, right? Whatever else is in a city. So remember when you, I do remember when I was a little kid and my parents were sending me to the grocery store down the street to buy something. Too much at that time. The shops were quite empty. But my mom always said, why don't you ask the old lady at the first floor if she needs anything? So basically there was I don't know, a contribution to society. That is kind of being a good neighbor. And this is something that I also heard in one of the podcasts I was listening this week about public diplomacy, and it was about public diplomacy as states were doing after during the World War II and after the war, kind of trying to convince other countries that they want to be a good neighbor and they're not they do not want to conquer or something like that. So basically that is what we would like to have. This is the answer. This is the answer, the essence of contribution to the society. To be a real member of a community is to be a good neighbor, right? And as you can see a couple of pictures here, why you can love a town, why you can love its people. And I'm sure all of you have your hometown, or even if Bucharest is your hometown, you still can find a lot of things that you would like, and here it starts with a little bit of events, a little bit of actions. It was before the elections last year, the parliamentary elections. It was a small event with these three people talking to 18 year olds, about their first vote. Why is important to vote? Why is important to vote in the for the European Parliament? What's the European Parliament doing? And so on. So all of them, except me. I mean, Mikey and Sandra, they are both from DEVA, and they accepted after 2 seconds to come home from wherever they were at that point for this event to talk. 18 years old about the importance of being a good citizen. And being a good citizen, it is quite part of being a good neighbor. It is a civic involvement that all of us can do, even if you're not on the stage talking to people, even if you are here and listening about what and how the involvement can be. It is about a cultural involvement, a small film festival that was done together with the local authorities. That is a good example of cooperation between civil society and local cooperation. It is about sports. It was that was quite a big event. It's a good job. This was quite a good event. It was kind of symbolic. People were running for 750 minutes. That means 12.5 hours. Continuously, like the relay, symbolizing
standing there as if we should meet. And I knew with you it'd be easy.
Kind of symbolizing the continuous history of the town. And it was quite beyond expectations, as from 8 o'clock in the morning to 8:30 in the evening, we had more than 750 runners, which we were hoping for, but we didn't think that will happen. So after 750, we gave numbers to all of them. It was from 1 to 750. And once we reached 750, all the numbers that we gave after was 800. Kind of symbolic for the next big number, for the next big age of the town. So the entire budget of this event was 300 lei. Yeah, we had a couple of partners that were giving kind of fruits to people, you know, and sweets and water. But in terms of money, it was 300 lei. And we had one day of community celebrating the community, you know? And people of all ages. It was my mother-in-law that come there without telling me before. So it was, and they were running for 1 minute. They did. So it was continuously people running for 750 minutes. So this is something in sport, but you also can do something kind of social. And it is something that we can all relate to, right? The lack of blood. So go and donate blood, but before starting a campaign on that, I never donated blood. So I thought the personal example. How can I run a campaign on donating blood if I never donated, if I'm not a donor? So I went and I realized that the personal example can be a very good example. And I asked my friends, this is a British citizen living in Devon, Adam Peckle. He's a photographer. And I asked Colin Hamilton, which is an Irishman, well, from Northern Ireland, basically, so easier. And they came, and it was, I would say, it was an example from them to the people of Devon, and also a statement coming from them that they want to be a part of the community. They want to contribute to the community. They want to connect with the local community. And it is also the mini communities that can, it is something that we do in PR. It is about the influencers. You all know about the influencers. But I think it is very successful, not only useful, but very successful to work with micro-influencers, which are people that small communities trust. So working with mini communities, this lady is a member of the runners community. And these guys, they are dancers. So basically they were an example of involvement in their communities of runners and dancers and volunteers. And it was a bigger event which attracted a lot of volunteers with a mobile center for blood donation. And we had about 70 donors from 9 o'clock in the morning to, I would say, 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So it is the social involvement. And I convinced this guy, which is a very dear and old and close friend of mine, and maybe his name is known to you. He's a famous Romanian movie director. His name is Adrian Sitaru, and he's also from Deva. And he said in kind of 2 seconds, "Of course I'll come." So his voice here is in Romania, so I'm sorry for people who are not speaking Romanian. Mainly, he was kind of asking people to feel better about themselves and donate.
Thank you.
So basically, it's simple. Always be a good neighbor. And to conclude, it's like people wants to be involved. They will happily help. They will contribute and will be inspired by ideas and causes and whatever they feel, they are a part of. And I think we can all be that kid that helps the old lady from the first floor. And I think we can all be the parents that educates children that way, right? And we can always be a personal example for anyone else. And we can all be dedicated, we can all volunteer, and we can be members of the community, no matter if we are citizens or individuals or a representative of organizations, a PR department in a big company, and that will make us feel good and proud about our contribution to society. And basically that is the end of the presentation, but I also want to talk about a little bit about the role of the Romanian PR Association in this. It's like I've been to RRP, which is Asociația Română de Relații Publice, the PR Association. It is a member of ICO. ICO is International Communication Consultants Organization. And as a member of ICO, we get to participate to board meetings of the international organization. And I think it was last year or 2 years ago when I participated to the board meeting in Budapest. And our colleagues from there, they took that opportunity meeting people from all over the world, from their industry, in giving us an overlook of the Hungarian media, which is highly controlled by the government. So that is a role that a professional association can have in the civic diplomacy, right? And an association like this is an international actor, right? So it has a role on with the foreign public, if you want. It is what this organization or this kind of organization can do. They can promote the country's industry of public relations. They can promote through memberships to ECO like that. They can promote campaigns and Romanian projects in the ECO competitions. So I would say it is civic diplomacy. It is anything that civil society, which includes individuals and whatever you want, did to let the foreign public know. It was like with the Governance Ordinance 13, right? Like years ago. Everything that people was doing in order to let the foreign public know that it is something bad happening here, that's civic diplomacy. And every kind of involvement, I think, it's welcome and will make us feel better. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cătălin.
Yeah, professional associations, I think, are a catalyst for actually getting the word out and empowering people or giving them the tools or the knowledge to actually move forward and have a bigger individual or organizational impact. Talking about organizations, we're going to move forward towards representatives of NGOs. And I'm gonna invite Cosmin to tell us a little bit about what Funky Citizens do. What the organization, in general, and his perspective on our own.
Thank you. So we have internet on this computer, I see, so I might show some links. Thank you everyone for being here. It's a wonderful day. Spring is almost here. Thank you to the other speakers for inspiring me. I wish I was a bit more involved in the academia, as the examples provided by Camelia were thought-provoking, and I hope we have a bit of time to discuss on them. I'm side basically, so I earned my wings in the streets, so to speak. It shows you photos of protests. I was there very much involved. I'm gonna go real quick through this presentation to show you a bit what we do, but first I'm assuming most of you are Romanian, but do I see a raise of hands who is not from Romania? 1, 2, 3, 4, okay. So in Romania we have this saying, has de necaz, which I don't know how to translate, we make fun of our... it's a coping mechanism, a psychological coping mechanism. So it's very useful for that, for going forward when something bad happens, right? The government does a bad deal and it's like, ah, let's gossip about it and have a beer and it's all fine. But what we do as funny citizens is not only talk this talk, this informal talk at peers, but we also walk the walk, I think. So this is what our aim is. We try to convince citizens that they're not just plain inhabitants of a city, right? But they have their rights and freedoms and so on. So I'm gonna go real quick, let's see how we can use this thing. Oh, it's working. Funky. Funky is a funny word. You might be familiar with the funky musical genre. You might have heard of James Brown, who basically invented this genre. And he was quite an activist, by the way. He lived in the times of the civil rights movement in the States. It can also have the other connotation when there's a funky smell, so I'll leave it like this. Sometimes what we do is quite wrong, so to speak. We do various stuff. This is a small booklet we did, the Romanian Constitution in a funkier version. But basically, we come from the intersection of communication, tactics, strategies, and executions, which is to say me, I'm the funky part of funky citizens, so to speak, and my colleague Elena, she is versed in the area of public budgets, public administration. So we try to intersect these two and make these very serious topics more easy to chew on. For instance, this pizza metaphor was used for explaining how public budgets work. We then invent a live cooking show and we try to use the culinary metaphor to explain what tax goes where and how this whole abstract thing of putting up a public budget works. We also did the collectible stickers with corrupt politicians, but these are, yeah, so we give a lot of a funky treatment to very serious ideas. We have a lot of work to do here in Romania, so basically this is what we want to do. We think that Funky Citizens is basically not our organization, right? We're just 7 people, but we do a lot of things with the help of our community. So Funky Citizens for me is kind of lifestyle, so to speak, a way of living. I think there are more Funky Citizens here in the audience. Maybe you don't know it, but you might be. So basically I found this drawing on the internet, which pretty much sums up what we do. The area we work in is called good governance, which is very neat and tidy. And yeah, this is the things that we want to do. We want accountability from our politicians. We want them to be transparent and competent, if possible, but that's a whole other issue. Until we get there, we must make sure that they're not very corrupt, so to speak. So we work in these kind of areas. We have a strategy which expires this year in 2020, so we're in the process of making up a new one. But basically we focus on 3 main topics: institutions, money, and the city. The Galaxy one is kind of a miscellaneous thing. For instance, if you have an idea and you don't have an organizational platform, you can come to us and we can lend our platform to borrow it from us. I mean, we just don't want to see any more excuses for people not doing it. So if you need an NGO, just take our vehicle and ride with it, right? We provide expertise and we work a lot with investigative journalists because we still have some, unlike Hungary, as you mentioned, where the situation is quite bad. These are the areas that we are very good at. And yeah, you were mentioning something about laws. We know how to read the laws and basically we translate from legalese to simple Romanian, which is quite complicated sometimes. We don't know how many laws we have in Romania. We don't know what the law is, I think. Right, maybe you can talk about Olivia. What is the law? Because we have laws in the parliament, in the council, in ministries, whatever. We do civic education because we started up with a project in about public expenditure, right? Because we all pay taxes, but we have no idea where those money go. For instance, I think in Switzerland, you actually pay your taxes. I mean, you make the bank transfer from your bank account to the state's bank account, so you see those money flying away. In Romania, if you are a personnel, maybe you do that, or if you are a freelancer, right? But if you work and you're employed for a company, then the money people in the company just take care of this for you, so you don't actually have this awareness of how you spend the money. But we realized after launching that project in 2012, it was called Banker Wasted high, so to speak, in translation, that it was way too high. So we need to lower the bar, you know. So we started doing civic education, and we started doing it with our peers. I'm 35 years old now, so we were working with 25 to 35 people, and now we went even lower, and we start with high school kids and even lower in gymnasium. We have this website since 2014, which is also part of the International Fat Checkers Network, a network that was very impressed with our small innovations in the field, like doing people like Olivia working in IT, sometimes do hackathons, we do checkathons, which is a marathon of fact-checking. For instance, when we had political debates and they were debating live, we did a real-time live fact-check and publishing. We also do things that nobody does, very complicated, geeky things that probably nobody reads, but we do them anyway. So basically we measured how much of the promises various governments actually managed to implement. And it's quite complicated. There were like 1,000 and something, no, almost 1,000 for the last government, so it was quite intense. We recently launched this local news project. Let's see how it goes. It's going pretty well. It's still growing strong. So we're a small media mogul. Now we have two editorial projects, Aqual and Latino Education, which is supposed to scale in other cities as well. Some screenshots from our website. We try to experiment and do other things. This I told you about. Oh yeah, this is what we really care about. So if I was to give a couple of words, rule of law, right? What is democracy? Romania is a democracy still, and we don't know how to use it. They didn't really teach us in school, they teach it nowadays. The teaching can get better, but we really need to grasp what democracy is. And again, going the IT metaphor, maybe it's like Linux, if you're familiar with the open source software. Linux has many distributions, so that's democracy. What is our ideal of how this Romanian democracy should work? And yet people make us and say we have an original democracy, and this is to say that it's not very good. So what is important to understand is that we are very agile. This makes us quite different and hard to grasp for people. I mean, we shift very fast what we do. I don't know how much time I have left. I have some time, so let's try, and I don't know if you can see things here. Let's see, can we find some? This one, is this one working? Ah, wow, okay. Oh, maybe again. I can just picking things up. No, I don't know. So, for instance, this is our headquarters during an event that we held a couple of years ago. I'm showing you this because it's representative for how funky things are. So it's our headquarters, but there was a projection mapping indoor. You can't really see it now because there's too much light. But this is the kind of thing we try to do. Like my presence here, and I'm very, very grateful for you having me here. I think it's very important to go outside the bubble and speak to other groups, because then we find this echo chamber effect. So we're trying to use our space, our physical space in which we work, to open it up, because we're all about transparency, right? To open up for various kinds of people. So we also do a lot of parties. We party a lot, actually, because I found out this is a good way to engage people. Where was the presentation? Was it here somewhere? Yes, it was here somewhere. So I could show you other videos. We do other boring stuff as well. Oh, okay, so it opens a new window. Interesting. Okay. For instance, we have this issue of public data. So we do a lot of optical character recognition. We scan. So basically, these are public bodies in Romania, which are supposed to be available for the public. But they give it to you in such a format that you cannot really use it for research purposes, right? So we made them in an open format in a couple of months. All the budgets for 4 years from all the counties. It was quite tedious and boring, so I just made this short video to show people, because people don't really know what's behind the scenes, right? So this is how it works. It's basically Photoshop for public budgets, for public documents. Basically, they have the source file, but they just print it, scan it, and send it to you as a scanned PDF. So we need an editable PDF to do analysis, and based on those analysis, propose public policies that might not be good for the city, right? Yeah, so it's a short one. It will end soon. We do a lot of things, and I will talk about the protests as well, because we mentioned that we don't really organize protests, but we support them as individuals and as an organization. So yeah, this process was repeated by our colleagues, I don't know, hundreds of times, thousands of times. So now you get something like this, right? So you got to do it in Excel, and then you can actually use the data. It's almost ready. And this is fast forward. Just to get this, right? So you just kind of solve this data. Nowadays. This is our team, by the way, so we're like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 people, because mother's not really busy, but raising this baby, so he's not really working for us. We did a lot of projects for him. So this one was successful. We teamed up with this guy who apparently likes to talk on camera, knows how to draw, and knows how to film himself, so he explains really civic concepts in an internet-friendly manner, and this video got a lot of shares, I don't know how many, but it reached 6 million and something people on Facebook. It was about the president and his role and what the president does. Maybe you've heard about this project, it's called Desafui. We do a lot of serious stuff when we have elections, and thank God we have elections in Romania a lot of time. Like 2024, we'll have all four rounds of elections in 1 year, so enjoy the break. Until then, we have a 4-year break, but this year we still have two rounds to go. So we encourage people to go out and be independent and observe the voting process, if it's correct or not. So we did this PR stunt last year, where we made up a pop-up gallery of, how should I call it, talk electoral in Romania. In Romanian it would be electoral bribes, so to speak. Traditionally, what political parties give to people to stimulate them to vote for them, and then we encourage people to go and counter this toxic behavior that comes from the parties with a healthy behavior coming from the citizens. We have this new physical space that some of you know about. It's a long story here, but basically, we have recreated an apartment that looks like a communist apartment in the 80s, and we use it as a civic education lab. We come there with kids. High school kids, and we pass them through a series of experiences like an escape room, and at the end they actually learn what rights and liberties are, but not just theoretically, like me speaking here to you about rights and liberties, but by actually experiencing them physically. And we have a debriefing session at the end where we talk with them and see what the other students own. We do other events, we travel, and hopefully one day this will grow into a proper museum of communism in Romania, which we don't have, and which we need, because we don't really have a social crisis going on. And you mentioned as well communist times when there was nothing to buy, and we still have trauma from back then, and we need to have closure with this trauma in order to progress as a society and move forward. This is what I think. Sometimes I DJ at parties. This is another way to do community building. We believe very much in community building, so we organize parties that are called fun protect, because we're fun citizens, right? So we play music, and our crowd gathers there and socializes. Because what we learned at the end of my slides. Yeah, perfect. Yeah, okay, cool. I'd like to talk about the progress a bit, because I have you inspired me to share some thoughts, because I was really involved in the 2013 protests. And by the way, you mentioned literature. We also tried to do a photo. We did a photo album about Romanian protests. It's a big book with a lot of photos, maybe you know about it. It has a good intro written by sociologist Diceanu, which explains how those protests came to be. And I think I also contributed to a series called the Romanian Protest.info. Maybe you know that one as well. It has a lot of explainers on how the protests came to be. So in the 2013 ones, yeah, I had no theoretical knowledge, but I tried to get involved and organize that movement. That movement was called Salvăm, which translates as United We Save, roughly in English. It was about a gold mine in the mountains of Romania somewhere. The movement had been going on since the early 2000 years, but it reached a tipping point in 2013 when the government passed a law for that company to start exploiting the natural resources, which triggered a lot of people. It triggered people that care about the rule of law, like me, and other people, nationalist people. So it was very non-homogeneous. This is the challenge. How do you unite under the same banner in all these kind of groups that otherwise would probably fight each other? And this was a huge challenge. And yet, the Facebook, you know, yeah, we pretty much rely on Facebook, everybody, the media, the politicians, the citizens, they're very avid Facebook users. I used to be on 2007, but then I kind of abandoned because it's quite handy there and sad, I don't know. So, we used Facebook. Facebook is very good for, as you mentioned, short-term stuff. And you can scale very easily. But then, if you want to grow and have a strategy, it becomes really complicated to have debates and issues on Facebook with the real stuff. It's also complicated to have debates offline, and we tried those things as well. The story there was quite simple. People were chanting in the streets. There was a slogan. They were chanting in the streets, "United we save." Rocha Montana was the name of the town, the village where they wanted to build the mine, right? So that was the chant, "United we save Rocha Montana." We took that chant and we just used the first bit, "United we save," thinking that in the future, if the movement is successful, we might save other stuff, right? This was the rationale behind the decision. And maybe it's a way of doing a bit of diplomacy. It kind of failed, but I think it inspired the subsequent movements, the ones in 2015, the whole Cmeciu you mentioned, the ones in 2017. So, yeah, I'm happy to talk about this kind of topics because I was there and I had a kind of a hands-on experience. It looks very different from the street level. It's very chaotic, it's very, very rough and crazy and mad, and people are really mad. But this is what makes it so fun, right? I think I will stop now and maybe we can talk more in the, thank you.
All right. Thank you very much. I think it's crucial, the work that you do, translating, legalese, as you said, or other difficult topics into information that people can actually understand and use. An informed civil society is one that can actually defend itself when it's the case and develop itself. It's very difficult to protect your rights when you don't really understand how they are handled. So that was actually how I got acquainted with funky citizens, when you did one of these translations. All right. Last but not least, moving towards an I don't know if IT is as difficult to understand as law, or maybe not. It depends on who you ask. So I will let Olivia tell you a little bit about what Code for Romania does and exactly how they can actually develop it or enhance a civic approach. All right. So, All right.
Hello, everyone. My name is Olivia. I come from a communications background. I finished journalism and communication sciences, and at some point I switched to IT. I'm not a coder. I do not. If you would depend on me to code to save your life, I would not be able to do so. I act now as chief operating officer in Code for Romania, which basically means I'm in charge with everything from sweeping the floors up to diplomacy in the civic space. These are a few numbers about Code for Romania. We started in 2016. At that point in time, we were a bunch of us, a couple of us in Romania, more of us in diaspora. It is a civic movement that started from diaspora in the Netherlands, Spain, and the United States of America. There were a couple of people who said, what can we do to help our country other than voting and donating as citizens in diaspora? We looked around, we started researching, and we figured out that there are a couple of models that we can apply. One of them was Code for America, the other one was Code for Poland, the other one was Code for Australia, and slowly we started to realize there's an entire network of Code for organizations. Our mission, specifically in Romania, every Code for works independently, has their own protocols, their own procedures, which is part of a network to support each other on a global level. Code for Romania has a mixed model between Code for Poland and the United States, and a bit of Mexico, a lot of Mexico actually, because it's a very culturally similar And we decided we're going to work with public institutions and civil society in order to equip them with necessary digital instruments for them to do their job properly. So we're sort of the second of civic movements. As I was listening to the presentations ahead of me, I started realizing that we speak a lot about protesting, a lot about activism, and this is something we never did as going from Romania. We are a 1,200 people group now. In 4 years, we grew from three to this number, which is quite huge. And we've never positioned ourselves as activists. We are doers. What we do is that we go and speak to organizations like Funky Citizens and ask them, okay, what do? You explain the law, you do electoral observing, monitoring, what can we provide you with? A very good tool for free so you can do your job better. We're also looking into healthcare, we're looking into education, we're looking into vulnerable groups, transparency and accountability, and also environment. We have six major fields, and we try every year to research several bits of these fields. We take a new topic every single cycle. We understand the problems, the pain points, we understand what has been done from a technical perspective, both in Romania and across the world in the field, and we come up with digital solutions that can be implemented. This is the main program, the Civic Labs of Code for Romania, where we do in-depth research and identifying solutions. The second program is the actual development. So this is where the over 1,000 volunteers get involved, and we have a maximum of six digital projects at any given moment developing in inside Code for. We also started to expand regionally, so you will see Code for Iași, Code for Brașov, for Timișoara, for Bucharest, and Cluj-Napoca that started growing and acting on a local level by importing the same model we have on a national level. We work from 11 time zones. The diaspora is currently the second largest group in Bucharest in terms of volunteers. And we've put up, we've actually counted how many hours we've worked. It's very easy for us to count exactly how much we work. So we have GitHub, Slack, and everybody's counting exactly how much code has been written and how much did it take us to build a solution or another one. And we also have to see how much we saved civil society and sometimes institutions in cash. So we've produced software worth 2.5 million euros up to this point in time. I think it's actually a bit bigger because these numbers are from last year. So enough about us. I'm going to switch a bit to the diplomatic part because I've realized my research for this talk and thinking that I've been for 4 years by going into every single country, every single event, into PR offices and companies, and always talking about how we can bring together more actors, actually have an impact on several by getting more people together to implement the solution. And we also, in terms of a network, we also have some goals on a global level as Code for All. So, coming back to our perspective on diplomacy. When we first launched in 2016, among the goals that we had to provide the necessary infrastructure for people in IT to actually volunteer, and have a small parenthesis here, we realized that even before our official launch in 2016 in September, that we were starting to address a group of people that had never actually volunteered before. So we were looking at developers who weren't necessarily good at doing activism, who weren't good necessarily to, I don't know, plant a tree, or go into a very specific, like, for example, I cannot ever go volunteer in homes. Emotionally, I am not built to do this, to go and work with institutionalized children. I'm only going to do them more harm. However, I can build an app that collects data, that provides other NGOs with enough data for them to start working on public policy, to make their point in front of institutions, and so on and so forth. So I am more useful in this kind of environment. And just like me, and just like other developers across the country, when they realize they can actually contribute, and they don't have to build an app all by themselves, they realize, okay, this is the place where I can be. Another thing about software is that it's not something you do in a weekend. We don't do hackathons because we do not believe in hackathons. We have hack days. I think we should change their name though because it's too close to hackathons. We do hack days, but the hack days are not, let's come together and in one weekend we're just going to snap a solution and it's going to be fun.
functional. It doesn't work like that. You need research, you need design, you need a lot of incubation, you need a lot of work on every single module and component. You need to understand how it fits with all the other tools, with the public institutions and so on and so forth. It's a lot of work. But we figured out a way how everyone can get involved and start working on projects, contributing with just simple tasks. So we hold the entire infrastructure, we build the entire architecture of the systems, and we say, hey, you start just build this login module. And another person across the globe is going to build the other part of the back end of the login module. They're going to come together and make it all happen. So we have volunteers that have worked for 4 years on the same projects, or that have worked for 2 days in 6 different projects. So for them it's easy, and they don't have the excuse, I can't get involved into a software development project anymore, because it's really easy. You can take a 2-hour task, or a 7-hour task, or a 2-month task. It's up to you how much you want to get involved. After, it took us 2 years to get to this model, we weren't brilliant from the beginning, so to say. But we figured a way to get these people to get involved. And then we looked at the bigger picture. We looked around Romania and we realized there are other countries that have kind of the same issue. Like, for example, with Moldova, not having a language barrier, it's very easy to translate any app that we're doing into Moldova and they can use them as well. Building everything open source allows us to just replicate the code and everybody to be able to use it in a matter of days or weeks, depending on the complexity of the solution. Then we realized it's not just Moldova, because code is written entirely in English, it's documented in English, so anybody can take it. And we started talking to other groups, going into Code for All Network and figure out, what are you working on, what am I working on, can they go together, can we replicate each other's solutions and save money and time in implementing them and benefiting from them. One example that these relationships between countries I can give for this is Mexico. Mexico had a massive earthquake in 2017, and Code for Mexico at that point in time developed 24 digital solutions to help with the aftermath of the disaster. What they did was missing people's databases, fact-checking tools, automatic transcription of official documents, managing resources and donations coming from other places, automatically given to requests from across the country, and so on and so forth. Right now, we are redeploying several of these solutions here in Romania because they're already built. We've adapted them to our legislations and our protocols that the DSU has here in Romania, and they're ready to go online. So, thanks to these relationships, we started to understand that it's not just about trying to bring the problems to the table, but also to adopt the solutions. So we facilitated this communication. Second, the moment when we realize we're doing good and this communication between countries and different projects was when one of our projects, our flagship project, so to say, which is the election monitoring tool, got redeployed and used without us even knowing. So we got an email from Togo a couple of months ago telling us, we have elections, we found your code on GitHub, we've redeployed the app, we're going to use it to monitor elections here in Togo, but we have a problem. There's one word in Romanian we do not understand, and that is, what is președinte of secție votare? They're having troubles in actually translating the forms that people were supposed to answer. Currently it's going to Sri Lanka, it's been used in Poland when they had their first election, and it all started from one app developed in 2016 in Romania. Again, what we also do is we try to attend as many events as possible. So from this perspective, our goal was to put Romania on the global map of civic technology at a point when nobody in Romania actually knew what civic technology is. They were saying, we had some initial groups that were, it was Poiana, Baranga, Blocana, there were some informal groups of people that were doing civic technology but did not put this name on it. But then we started, okay, we adhered to Code for All, we entered the network, and then we also went as far as to have representatives in the executive committee of Code for All. We've put in a lot of effort, and we brought the Code for All Summit, the first open doors Code for All Summit, and we made it here in Bucharest in order to show as much as possible the capacity that we have, and to try to explain to our government, public institutions, and especially local administration, how they can use something like civic technology in their day-to-day work. Also, what we're doing by going through to all these events and talking to people is to draw the attention on a topic that we rarely speak of, which is funding. Culturally speaking, we are people that generally hate asking for money. However, in order to develop civic technology is really expensive. As you've seen that number, it's really expensive to produce software. At the same time, the context is in such a way that we don't see the same level of funding in this area because people don't really understand it. It was endless times when we ended up in CSR offices and people told us, you're illegals, you can't be, you're not charities, you're not doing protesting, you're doing production, you can't be an NGO. It took us 4 years to get people to understand exactly what we're doing, and we also had to fight the idea that you're the IT guys, you're the best paid professional category in this country, why should we give you money? Anyway, we're moving forward and we keep on trying by bringing examples and by bringing other representatives from other coding stores around the world to explain people exactly what the impact of civic technology in public administration, in public sector, in civil society is, in order for them, if you don't believe me, because I'm the person that's randomly appeared in your office, look at how the government of the United States works with the U.S. Digital Services and Code for America and what this has meant for the public space over there. In terms of diplomacy, again, we put a lot of pressure on ourselves to always be there and answer for any kind of request and any kind of invitation to talk about how we can come together as regional partners, because this is kind of the only way, at least in civic technology, to get enough funds to build projects that can be easily replicated across the region. Usually budgets in Romania are, let's say, between 10,000 euros up to 50,000 euros. That's kind of the medium sum for a CSR project. Usually when you're trying to build something regional, 50,000 euros is just going to be the technical solution. That's easy. If you have something complex other than a WordPress website, that's going to be it. And what we're doing is trying to access funding that would benefit both Romania, maybe Hungary, maybe Serbia, maybe Moldova, and we're trying to figure out ways to facilitate this. For example, we're trying to access funds to help. Currently, we're actually starting Code for Moldova entirely these months, and we're trying to access funding to also give support constantly to newer code for such as Code for Czech Republic and Code for Hungary that's trying to actually launch for a couple of years now, but it's being really blocked because the situation is a bit complicated, exactly as was being said over there. Nobody's really keen to see some geeks trying to open data and bring more transparency to whatever is going on there. I really hope I didn't go past my time. I would really like to engage with the other members of the panel, especially. I've been a couple of weeks ago into a panel about organized by the European Commission on civic engagement in Europe. And they were talking, again, the same topic was up there about protesting and the movements. We consider to be ourselves a movement, even though you have never seen a Code for Romania logo in Piazza Victoria, in Victoria Square. Our individual members go to protests, it's their right and their, but as an organization, we don't discourage protesting, we just don't think that movement means just being on the street. It's essential to have people on the street because otherwise you don't get a public agenda about what's going on. But once you come up with a solution, it's important to have also those tiny ants that are building the solutions that you can work to do more efficient protesting. Thank you so much.
I saw a woman on IT talking about civic movements and being a diplomat for an organization that I actually followed for the last years. And I said, yes, I need to have this in the panel because I know you can have an input on how I saw you. So, geez, successful action. Okay, so thank you very much for this input. We are going to move towards the debate, towards the interaction. And
there are a lot of layers to discuss. So we are not going to stay here until the weekend. But I do have some dimension that I would like to have your input on, and maybe start from there. So starting from the idea that, Cătălin mentioned it before, this is the starting point of how we in the MARPE project begin to discuss civic diplomacy. So basically, when we talk about civic diplomacy, we did talk about the independent diplomatic activities of non-state actors working across borders, so this is an important element, whether they engage state market entities or other civil society organizations. So we do have a layered perspective, because when you talk about traditional diplomacy, you have state engaging state to advance their agenda. When you have public diplomacy, you have state engaging other public opinions to advance their agenda. When you have corporate diplomacy, you have corporations, organizations engaging the states. But when you have civil diplomacy, who engages who? What is the agenda? How is the agenda advanced? And even more importantly, there is an issue that we don't have in other types of diplomacy. How is the agenda formed and understood? That's why I said when Cosmin was talking that it is important to understand topics in order to actually form an agenda. So this is what I would like to talk about, focusing on the Romanian context. So taking into account motivation, the actors who engages who, and the actions. My first question, so I have two major questions. So, is there any diplomatic approach or dimension, as you understand it, included in the actions of Romanian social movements? So is there any dimension of civic diplomacy? Because we are a young diplomacy, we are a funky diplomacy, as you said at some point, we are an original diplomacy with all that encompasses. But do you see any civic diplomacy dimension in what has happened in Romania, let's say in the last decade, maybe? Starting from that let's say, definition. It's a bit more much, but definition. You can jump in at any point. I would like to have everyone's opinion, but we can start in not the alphabetical order, or if you want to keep the alphabetical order, this is where you have more control over the order. Does anyone want to start?
Oh, I said I'm going to start first. So there is, speaking exclusively for Romania, what I would sort of put in the box of diplomacy is what the civic movements through their leaders do in order to get their messages of the people up to the government. So you're talking about public policy propositions, sending representatives in order to talk to these institutions to get specific legislation moving forward, and so on and so forth. And I think also that there is a lot of, I'm just going to give our example. We have a few points in our code of conduct. We will never take money from the state. We will never engage in crimes that we don't believe in, and so on and so forth. But however, we do have signed agreements with the state, and we work together on policies regarding open source and government or any other kind of digital Romania kind of plans. It's not necessarily we don't work for them, but what we do is try to always provide them with the necessary expertise and to make sure that our points are always mentioned and kept on their agendas all the time. So it is an effort, it's a communication effort, but we constantly do that. And what we also do is we try to bridge this gap, as I was giving you the example of local administration. Through the entire network that we have outside Romania, we're trying to always put in contact the officials in Romania with officials in other states in order for them to gain experience one from another. But we're actually currently trying now to get the US Digital Services model maybe implemented in Romania. It's just a matter of negotiation and constant advocacy and meetings over meetings. So it's a lot of work going on over there. And I think Cosmin can speak for years when Funky actually was who advocated for a lot of changes and has been the voice of their group.
I actually wanted to speak about it. reality, rather than individuals living 40 kilometers away in Otope, for instance. I mean, it's a global thing right now, and yeah. going back to this box of diplomacy that I need to put stuff into. Right, so I have a communication background, so of course I believe that it's very, very important and necessary to engage various audiences in various manners. But some other people would argue that no, some NGOs don't need to have contact skills, whatever, they just need to go and help their cause, which I disagree. And yeah, this is what we do. So there's a lot of work being done, as you said, under the hood, things that are not visible in the streets, right? So what happened in 2017 was a tipping point when protests actually became mainstream. So besides those protests that you saw in Piazza Victoria, and which were a black swan for Europe and kind of saved us in this comparison that's ever going to be Romania, Poland, and Hungary, which had illiberal tendencies, we're quite a bit better off, I would say, than those two countries. And whenever we meet with colleagues in the region, because we're also part of these networks, that we have something in common with the Central and Eastern Europe. There's more transparency in our body. So yeah, going back to my point would be that there's a lot of work to be done under the hood. And for instance, there was a big advocacy campaign. I would refer to our advocacy activities when we think about diplomacy, because in this way we engage with peers, with other NGOs, and we try to form coalitions and networks and see where's the common denominator and how we can work together. Then we can also, we should also, and we will also engage with supporters coming from various areas, like the other NGOs from other fields, companies even, and then we go and discuss with the political factors, right? So there was a big campaign going on, 2014, I think it started. You're quite old, I don't know, it's hard for me, my brain doesn't work yet. Called Politics Without Barriers, right? Its aim was to change the law that allows you to start a new political party, because you went to 5,000 signatures to start one, and there were other criteria on the list. And they negotiated, and the whole process took for about 2 years, right? And now you can start a party with 3 members, and there are new parties that started that benefited this law, like parties, so yeah, this was an effort that the people who are actively involved in, my colleague Paul, is no longer working with us, but we're still friends, working with you, I see nowadays a lot. He doesn't really want to talk about it that much because it was probably quite traumatic for him, because in any negotiation, he got some, but he lost some, so it wasn't ideal. But it was not. For us, it's constant. As you said, we go, my colleague Elena, she's like the face of the organization. And I always joke about this thing because her name is Elena. We had a leader called Elena, back in the days. And I always talk about her, that she's going and having this cult personality. But she goes and engages with the media, and she's invited, she speaks at various events. She goes and engages with companies and politicians and whatnot. So we're trying to communicate and find the common denominators. That would be my stake in this game of diplomacy. Whereas what I saw, and I'm ending my intervention with this one, what I saw in the trenches of the protests when I was there in 2013, I was there at every protest basically as an individual, not as a representative of foreign citizens, because we also believe in other ways of helping people out. But what I saw there is that people were very radical, less willing to talk to people that have different opinions. So this is a concern for me, because I think there's a gap, right? We're clear, very flower power, everybody needs to communicate and be diplomat, and have tact and finesse. Whereas, when you go out in the actual crowd of people, you will find that the situation is more rough. So how can we chisel the situation a bit? This is my constant concern, and this is why I try to be a kind of interface between the grassroots and the top level. So this is where I see myself and my work. But yeah, there's a lot to there's a lot to discuss about this one. I think I will actually.
I would like to pick up from what you said. are looking at the people on the streets those days. Mm-hmm. I don't know how many knew why they were there. I don't know how many knew about the laws, what it means, what was written in it, what all these people are shouting about. It was only something, an expression against something or a rage which came out. But I think we lack education. I think if we are looking on social media and Facebook, so and talking about boundaries. We are here, small Romania, but the entire Romania, so the boundaries around Bucharest, looks different. So yes, we have our social media channels, yes, we read, but I don't know how many Romanians understand what they read. I really think that you guys have a lot to do.
Yeah.
So I congratulate you for this, because everybody is living in a bubble, and what you are trying to do is to increase the bubble to education and to everything you do. And on the other hand, yes, we have all these nice people, they understand diplomacy, they want to do the good stuff, they want to have a civic movement, they want to have this grassroots. But besides the education at our level, we have also to think about the people we are talking about, so talking about advocacy. Who are we talking about in, let's say, back there in the pyramid? And I really think that before talking about diplomacy, we should think about how to educate all these people and what role everybody plays in educating all the young people, because we see a lot of young people looking at the communism era with good eyes. And this is also because they don't learn about what communism meant. And we see also young people in a radical position. And I really think that all these guys' work is very difficult if we don't, as society, put all the heads together and try to educate the younger generation about what diplomacy means, what democracy means, what communism meant, how the society can change, what their role is in the society. They don't understand that, I don't know, if they, yes, you're right, if I'm working, how much money from my work goes to the government, what are they doing with this? We don't have the notion of asking our leaders to show us their work, because we are paying them. So only in the street, yes, we hear, show us what to do because we pay you and so on, but I don't, the masses don't understand. So, and I think we should try to find a funky language for everybody to understand in order to move things forward.
To understand what you need to do, because sometimes it's difficult to actually identify exactly what the dimension, where you need to act. So from what I understand from you, basically an important step is trying to bridge the gap between what actually is going on in the street and in society and where exactly our discussion is. Because oftentimes in NGOs, in academia, we talk a lot about this, and we research it, we talk with others, but usually it happens at a higher level than what is going on in the street. Maybe bridging the gap could be a next step before actually engaging in international diplomacy and things like that. We need to make a step towards that.
Probably unpopular opinion. I also think that these recently born diplomats, which are the civic movement's leaders that are going to address the state, also has a responsibility to understand the other actor as well and get their messages across to the people, because it has to be a dialogue. It can't always be just pointing fingers, you're not doing your job, you're not spending your money right, you're not. There are, other than what we see on TV, like the politicians that we usually love or hate, there are a lot of people working and a lot of people without enough resources to do their job properly. We should also take some time and listen to them as well and to understand exactly how to balance this. It's not just about shouting and pointing out the negatives.
Can I just just add a thing about, you mentioned going out of the bubble, so let's go into concrete and let me show you an example of how going out of the bubble looks like for me. I was trying to research a material that was supposed to be a protest today, people against Pax Oxygen, which is a measure that was, should I explain, you know about it anyway. Anyway, so I was talking to people who are against this measure.
Maybe for our international guests.
The Bucharest City Hall tried to put up not a congestion charge, but a green charge for cars, older cars, polluting cars going in the center. But now, since we have local elections looming, the mayor decided to take that law back, so it repealed the law. So I don't know if the protest is still going on, but I was trying to talk to people who are against this tax and to see what their opinion is. And anyway, I talked to this guy, and then out of the blue, without me asking him anything, he just spit out the random stuff that I'm going to read you. It's in Romanian, but I will do a short summary at the end. So, it says like this. Nu avem de ce să ne ascundem pentru că scopul meu este doar să nu fiu de acord cu taxa oxigen ca mulți alți bucureșteni invadați de aia acasă de stăpân fanarioți aduși de vântul politic aiurea din țară. Nu mă văd nici revoluționar și cred încă în puterea votului. Uniunea Europeană este pe ducă și taia după coronavirus va ieși din Uniune dacă nu este gestionată criza corect. Deci terorismul ecologic va rămâne la ea acasă, stați așa, la olandezi, belgieni, suedezi și norvegieni și poate în Germania, care este motorul Uniunii, eu citesc cum scrie fără virgulă, dar că nu se după atentatele neonaziste zilnice, cărora le dat victime activiștii de mediu și iubitorii de emigranți, coronavirusul a fost punctul sensibil de pornire a isteriei securizării frontierelor și acum unii de fiecare scapă cum poate în scurt egoista lor, punct. Poloarea este praf în ochi, pentru că în spate se consumerismul și supraproducția ce nu mai are desfacere în Europeană. Vom asista la revolte în Franța, rasială, interetnice, deoarece piața este plină și Italia, fiind garantită o grămadă de muncitori, nu vor mai avea de lucru și vor demonstra. Uniunea Europeană, spus cu caps, este grav pusă la încercare de coronavirus pentru că arată de fapt incapacitatea de a se gestiona o criză în domeniul sănătății publice și dacă două state asemănătoare la tine comparate, noi și italienii ne vom descurca diferit, noi ca întotdeauna, adică vom muri pe capete și italienii se vor dovedi oare că este sau nu capabil o de compasiune și sprijin în fața cetățenilor de mână a doua cum suntem noi să-l întrebări. So I didn't really ask this guy anything, but he started this whole random spewing out of thoughts that some of them are rooted in some truth, I guess. But I don't know. So how do I address this? Because this is a symbol. There are more people like this. So we always talk about people not going out to vote, for instance, right? It's a common example. And you mentioned the going out to vote campaign that you were talking about this one. But let's face it, I mean, half of the people, for instance, in Bucharest, they don't go out and vote in local elections because they're disillusioned with the political options that they have. So they don't really think, let's face it, you go out and vote. Who are you going to vote? They don't like Firat, they don't like to short down these guys. I talked with them, they don't like anything, but this is why they don't turn out to vote. And yeah, and that's it. I close my
eyes. Yeah, you wanted to.
I want to show exactly how these people actually look, and I'm not going to position myself as an elitist or a populist, right? I'm just trying to see how we can find, it's a challenge to find a common denominator, so I didn't respond to this text that I got, but what should I respond? Yeah, that's very good.
You should respond yes.
Yes. Or no.
So,
yeah. What were you going to
do? I'll just say my points on the research part. So when we say, let us say, Europeans, Romanians, we like to go to some statistics. And I mentioned just one statistic coming from European Communication Monitor, which says that actually, okay, digital natives or us, they like to be critical. And the other finding in the European Communication Monitor is that they, as messages, they do love visuals. So the idea is, for, let us say, organizations who work in civic diplomacy to know how to frame the message, because you are right.
Without words.
Without short words, or without, for example, I was studying vaccination in Romania and for side effects, there was a link, and nobody was accessing that link because they were lazy to read the side effects in that link. So the problem is, let us say, maybe with us, but also with the common people, let us say, with citizens, to know how to read and to have the patience or the willingness, let us say, to stay there and read. That is a very important idea to follow. And coming to civic movements that we mentioned, okay, Cosmin was right, that there was, because I read, and actually published an article in Anna the protest, resist protest. Okay, there were different views there. And the interviews showed, there was no, let us say, coordination, and it was something chaotic. It was spontaneous, the figure was there, and it was spontaneous. Now, what we do actually is to, it is interesting to see how the messages evolved. And the resist protest was interesting for the visuals, because it was a sort of a challenge between protesters coming each night with different slogans, different messages, and the books that you mentioned, they were great, because it shows, that Romanians do love to mock, let us say, at stuff. Look at this coronavirus nowadays, the Facebook is full of, let us say, memes, because they are actually this type of messages. And it is interesting, but the point is, that, let us say, we do not have the patience to stay and listen to the other.
To stay and build.
And build together.
It's funny to make a meme on the internet.
And then you have to put up walls, let us say, to equal the other, and you create another meme and so on. And the chain is important. For us as researchers, that is a very good field to study, really, how citizens actually create these visuals and the slogans of the
thing. There's also a book with all the...
I know. I bought it, so I have it.
Yeah, it's very interesting. But also the 2013 process that I was doing, I know that there was a lot of creativity going on there, because also there was a media embargo on the process, so there wasn't really broadcast on news and so on. For instance, they even convinced Woody Harrelson to join the movement and show photo on the internet supporting the Ocean Montana Coast. So people there did a lot of extensive use of their PR skills to reach various people. I mean, there were people diving from planes holding signs to scuba diving. I don't know, they tried to go crazy with the whole thing. We formed the human chamber of the parliament. I don't know. So we were trying to reach out various audiences, but it's really, really hard to bridge gaps between generations also. For instance, we have the youngster that does it. Visual is very important. So we did a video about the rights of the pupils, right? The students. Many of them don't. They have rights. I mean, they have issues at school, and it's a very fine line. You got what? And he got a lot of hate on the internet, of course, which is a very fertile environment for hate, dividing people. He got a lot of hate from grown-up teachers, and but you are also very rude. And look at this guy. Who are you to talk? You should talk when experiment. Just a guy saying the law, you just chill and try to...
Yes, but our education system puts you there on
the
mercy.
Well, I have to disagree, coming from me. Let's say that not everyone. But the idea is that, here you have our students, so... Our group is very open. So they have rights, but at the same time they have obligations. The obligations that you have, And they do debate on that group, whatever comes through everyone's mind, let us say. So they are open. So
yes, but if we go back
during our times of
our time. If you go back to a couple of years in high school in schools, so I teach fake news in schools, and I know that every time I say something about an example of antenna 3 or whatever, somebody stands up and says, listen, you have no right to talk with these children about media and so on. And I say, but these children need to know how they can, identify fake news or whatever. But I cannot say anything about bad about antenna 3 with the teacher in the room. I cannot.
I think that there is a difference between the high school and the universities.
Yes.
Students are. They are more open. I think that they have the capacity of digesting all types of views. Maybe the high school system is a bit different. I did not.
No, but we are talking about visuals. We are talking about memes. About if you say, they are looking a lot of memes, and we videos and whatever. How much do they understand from?
So we use them as a hook, right? As a fishing hook to lure them towards us closer. So we have a funnel, and for the 6 million people to reach, probably, I don't know, 100 will be really in depth and involved
exactly.
with us.
If I may intervene just a little bit, because if you go to education,
yeah,
we're going to stay here until Monday. It's a
Let's
nice place, but it's a nice place.
We
have so, do you see any international dimension or potential for civic movements in Romania? Because right now we are focused a lot on building up a national level. Right? On getting people to understand what's going on getting people to understand their rights, how they can utilize various communication instruments. And we've seen during the protests that they have been utilizing them, right? But do you see any next step going international, not just a national level of debate and discussion? But then you want to intervene?
Global women in PR is a very good example of something that, it's a very good example of something that it's doing, it has a lot to do with the international world. A lot to do with the international world, right? The more we, through various, ways, through various instruments with the international community, will learn more and will be more able to become a bigger part of the international community, a bigger part of the EU, and also will be able to address bigger and more important problems through the civil movement and through all other uses or actions.
I would actually like to use your remark to ask you my second major question. So, when we talk about the actions of organization, either let's say associations like or NGOs like you have, or even we usually talk about informed people who have the knowledge and the skills to advance good messages. How can or what can we do? How can we help at mass level, at ground level? What can each of us, because each of you has a different perspective, what can we do to actually maybe build, develop, enhance a strategic, if possible, dimension to mass protests, to mass movements, not just movements that are moved forward by informed and knowledgeable individuals and professionals? Because that's where the gap actually forms.
Everything. We should continue everything that we're doing. We should continue, and we should get involved, and you should get involved in whatever you think, in whatever you believe in, and it's going to be hard to have an agenda, a common agenda, right? But as long as it is in the public interest, we should go on.
I think there are people who don't know how powerful they are. If we are looking at Greta, for example, so it started from one personal story, went international, and now we see.
That's a very good example of civic.
And now we see companies changing their environmental strategy or whatever. So it takes only one person to change the international mindset. But actually, I think what was helpful here was the authenticity. So a movement would actually evolve around a very authentic person with a very personal need and a very personal story.
You asked President Donald Trump, he disagreed. But he's the president of the United States, which is like
you can love or you can hate Greta. But
we're not debating Greta. Okay, I'm just saying that there is always
that's a big one.
Black or white.
Yeah,
so
but
kind of lost the moderation. I want to build on your example with
That's also with the black and white, that's really with Russian economy.
Yeah, true. I mean, where's the middle one?
Right? Would they have some, I don't know, being that paper of saying Russian economy of the people diving from most of them, or many of them, could have been like the people that were not clicking the link. What do they know about? Maybe it's just like a meme. Oh, I like this meme, so I'm going to support the cause.
Yeah.
Things are complicated, and we expect them to be as simple as a Facebook like, which is not always the case. But going back to your question, my answer would be, what can we do? I think we have another phrase from it, like Victoria, victories. So we should give people examples, positive examples of success, right? Of success stories. I mean, start small with a small thing and have success with that thing so you can be inspired to go and build other bigger things. For instance, you mentioned the Greta example, but there's this really great guy I met in the streets of the protest. He works for a logistics company and he drives a lot in traffic. And he was very upset that people were just dropping their cigarettes on the ground. So he started this campaign that grew organically, and now it's pretty successful. And he made use of diplomacy as well. And he's just a guy who had an idea. He's not an activist as a profession, right, or whatever. He doesn't work in an NGO. He got involved, and he had this success with this campaign called Moaruka Kishwacha. And now he convinced people in Brasov to put signs on the slopes. We convinced municipalities in the seaside to put those in the seaside, on the public roads, whatever. So he convinced a lot of public and private institutions just because he had the will and because his cause was really small enough. So I'm mentioning this example because we talked a lot about protests that are civic, about stuff like corruption. And yes, this is a thing that we could explore because you were also asking what we could do internationally. Romania had a pretty good run with anti-corruption until, I don't know, a couple of years ago. So some other states, such as, I don't know, Slovakia, for instance, were quite envious of us. You know, these guys are working. They're also, because in a democracy, obviously, you need more actors to work. We need to have free media, which we don't have in Hungary. We established that, so that's a problem. We need to have active and involved citizens, which we try to stimulate. And also, we need to have some new political parties as well. And the most important thing for me, and with this I will end, is of course the institutions, right? Because politicians come and go, but institutions remain. So we should focus the people on.
One thing that the civic movements and civil society in general cannot live without is actually the major contribution that academia has, and that is data. We're looking at a lot of data-driven activism in countries that can rely on very few data and that's actually transforming information for the masses, because even if you just throw Excel documents at people, it's still not going to cause any kind of reaction because they don't understand.
But do people believe data?
Yes, people do believe data if it's presented, argumented, and it just shows the facts. And if you're going to look at data, similar data in Hungary, Romania, maybe Czech Republic, and Poland, you're going to see common propaganda models, common phenomena happening can actually empower movements to become regional rather than just stay during after hours in the weekend being recreational in the streets in Romania, for example. So I think we're looking at a decade where data is going to be the key element moving forward.
But these people, this guy that
wrote that might be a little bit more nuanced because that guy is not going to be data.
People say we live in a post-truth society, so I have the fact checking website. It's hard for me to promote the scientific method that we learned in college because we're educated, right? But how can we,
I think there's no rational behind a big movement. It's more emotion. So
that's obviously true. So we work in communication.
You cannot move masses.
We know this
because,
yeah.
If it's just emotion, at some point, it's only going to be short-term because people have only this much energy resources to be on the street, and they need still to be fueled by groups of people that bring together again and other topics and consequences.
You need data for sustainability.
People are moved by emotions, they're not moved by data and by statistics.
There is tons of data about everyone in Bucharest, right? As we were talking about this thing earlier, and we don't see anybody.
I'm not saying that they are not people, but the messages that I give to people need to be informed by action.
Yeah.
Rooted in
hard
work.
I think that depends on culture. studies on civic movement. For example, I was using my comparative study Greece, Spain, and Egypt, the protests. The protesters were actually urged by different messages. Some of them believe in emotional framing, the other ones in rational framing. So it depends on the culture and on actually on the situation that is there. But I do believe that data should be there, really. I mean, outrage, let us kill him. Okay, let us kill him, but why should we kill him? At least.
Show me the data.
Show me the data.
In God we trust, the others bring data.
That is why I said about the framing lines, because they evolved during a protest. And while I was extracting actually the mission of corruptia ucide, corruption kills, it was interesting to see that they have no activity anymore on Facebook. That is important to have a permanent activity, in my opinion, to your question. Have a permanent activity, not to stop. Okay, we did the resist, let us stop, and so on. And another protest will come, let us start. Another community that is active is the Click. The Click one is very active.
But they're very different. I mean,
I know. But they are active nowadays.
They have a method. They use
Technology
a lot. They're part of international networks. And they use methods that work in Australia. Like they use methods that work in Mexico. And adapt them to the grassroots. Whereas Corruptia Ucide were just facilitators. This is why they're informal.
Mm-hmm.
These guys are informal.
Exactly. So, I have my questions, but I would like to know if there are any questions from the audience. I know Susanna always has a question. So we'll start with Susanna's question, and if you have any questions, please let me know.
Alright. Okay, thank you. First of all, I apologize because I was not able to listen to all of you. I had a personal problem, so I need to go out. Turning to the question, taking civic movements towards civic diplomacy, my question is, if we look for the definitions about the different functions of diplomacy, we can say, diplomacy is about representation, it's about support, it's about to protect the national interest, negotiations, and promote friendly relationship. And I mean this with other countries. In order to talk about diplomacy, whatever, what kind of diplomacy we want. So, to be diplomacy, we need to attend these functions and these functions through another country. And taking in this, how it's possible to bring civic movements to the level of civic diplomacy? Are we talking about civic diplomacy, or are we talking about civic communication? Because what I they are two different fields, communication and diplomacy. They work together, but different fields. So my question is, can we see on the civic movements this five dimensions of diplomacy in order to bring them from civic movements and communication, civic communication, to the level of civic diplomacy? Do you think it's possible, or do you think this idea of civic diplomacy is another thing?
But I'm not sure yet if it is desirable. I mean, public diplomacy, yes, it is desirable, but not the civic one. I'm not sure I can answer it. means some kind of a common agenda. But there is always going to be, and there always has to be, somebody that it is outside of the agenda, outside of the majority, with another interest, with another that doesn't fall into the agenda, and that doesn't mean that that is bad.
This is feasible.
No, it's not desirable.
I think that it depends on the society, what type of government that we have, what type of authorities that we have. For example, the example that you brought with the guy with the pistoche.
Mm-hmm. That would scare us, yeah.
Has someone stopped him?
No, people helped him. Because it's a cause that is not divided.
It didn't change to civic diplomacy, it didn't change to a law, it didn't change to...
It was
a
social movement,
yeah.
At national level, it didn't go beyond, to go towards diplomacy.
Because it just started and it's time, but it will probably reach a point in which we can formulate more articulate, I don't know.
I think it's very different. We are doing a lot of communication, less diplomacy, and I think communication, when you look at civic communication, as you well put it, it has a lot of objectives, but for the diplomacy you need one strong KPI, so I want to change this, I want to make this happen, I want for me to, have an impact on something, and actually the translation don't work very well. So because we have this gap between the masses and the strong people who can actually make things happen. But I really don't know, for example, this guy, very nice story, but did he had in mind to change something for everybody, or he wanted first to change something around him?
Maybe he wanted around him, and then this thing that doesn't grow.
Yes, but then he will need. But then he will need that.
He will need support.
Diplomat who actually can change something.
I gave his example because he actually is a very good diplomat, as in terms to communication skills, and he can.
But that's what happened to Greta. She wanted to change something around her. It's just that it scaled up very fast, very big.
Yes, but she needed people to make the diplomacy for her, because we saw a lot of people around her supporting her and doing things. Otherwise, it remained the communication campaign,
a social act.
Exactly, but she needed all the people from the society and from the political area to support her in changing something. Otherwise, it will remain at.
My question was, I was looking to the different functions of diplomacy.
The five. Can you say them again?
Yeah. So, the representation.
Yes.
Yeah.
The report. The protection of national interest. The negotiation and the promotion of friendly relations. And when I look for all of these functions, some of them are very clear for a civic movement. I can see a civic movement play this function, but for instance, the promotion of friendly relation with other countries, and the promotion of friendly relations with other countries, civic movements play a key role in this function of the promotion of friendly relations with other countries. So that's why I was asking you, because I was looking, and some of these functions, I am not sure that I can see civic movements playing.
I think Olivia has an answer.
Or even if it is possible, or even if it is aim, an objective, or even if it match with the identity of civic movements.
I have an example. I can speak only on the technology side, as being part of the forum at
We do have, for example, the common agenda. Every year we set our objectives, we try to analyze all our pain points, and we try to group these and to understand what position Code for All will take in specific aspects. So what do we do about environment? What's our position on this? What are we working on? Do we focus more? Like, do we group like 5 or 7 countries working on disaster relief and other 7 countries working on transparency and so on? And in terms of grassroots movement and actually coming together to change legislation for abusive systems, I think the best, I don't know if Romania can get into any kind of movement at this point in time with the level of civil society that we have currently, but Code for Africa is a very good example. Code for Africa encompasses 14 other group forces, Namibia, Uganda, and so on. And what they do is that they support each other, and they are a network of first learning, then working together on policies, providing themselves with experts in order to better their situations. So they are a very strong network, and they are a force that always is being used to impose the claims of specific groups in very in smaller countries. So they're working, they have a fantastic way of working. So Good for Africa is one of the best examples, and coming from very small groups, united together in a coalition. And what they also did by bringing them together, they managed to give access to the very small ones to international funding. They couldn't have done it if they weren't a network, if they weren't always communicating with each other and having a common agenda of what they want to implement in their countries. So I think I think Code for Africa is something that ticks pretty much all of those. And they're also present in any kind of World Economic Forum or another. They're represented in all the important major forums in the world.
If it's going to happen to that switch from the civic movement to civic diplomacy, if it's going to happen, I think it's going to happen in the European Union in order to strengthen the European Union or otherwise.
All right. Any other questions? Comments? Things like that? Because if not, I think we can all smell the food. And if there's one thing I learned is that while discussions are important, food is more important. When we started the ISP, we were doing an exercise, and I was in a team with Pepe, and we were discussing what culture is. And I told you that for me, culture is food. On that happy note, I would like to close today's event, to thank very much our speakers. I really enjoy, we really want to talk about the topic, and I really appreciate your effort and your engagement. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for listening. Please keep in touch with our project. It's already halfway through, so we have a lot of wonderful things coming. I think we can